Thanks. We're going to, it's the last session of the day, we are going to make it more practical. How many pairs have we got?
We should have at least five pairs.
Okay, so we're on two courts, that's good. So you'll be out there coaching them. Before we do that, we're going to do a little bit of demonstration of some routines to follow up on the questions I'm going to ask now. So, key role of the female in mix, please. What's the key roles of the female player in mixed doubles?
Attack the net.
Attack the net. Finish the rally. One, yeah. Again. What else?
Set up.
Set up, so you mean control. So control the net, finish at the net, and what else?
Force the lift.
Force the lift, yeah, control, yeah.
Dictate the play.
We're talking about modern mixed doubles. Modern mixed doubles. What's another key role for the play? It links back to the last session you just did on the doubles.
Placing space now.
Yeah, I think that's doubles in general. I think that's all doubles players.
So it's assist in defence these days?
Defence. Defence, that's probably the critical factor for a girl at high level now. What you're going to see this week, you want them to finish at the net, you want them to control the net, opportunities, yeah, you want them to close space down, but I think that's more general. But they've got to be able to defend. Otherwise, you're going to get in big trouble. Okay?
Because at the woman becomes a target.
Woman's always going to be the target. Woman's always going to be the target. It's normal. Except when it's margin, in my opinion. It's margin, because it's better than the mates. Role of the male. Differences between men's doubles and mixed doubles for the male player. What's the role of the male player in mixed doubles? Key points.
To be able to maintain a neutral position. Like, at times, like it's not his sole role, but you don't want to put your lady under pressure.
What do you mean by neutral position?
So playing to mid-court off returns, things like that.
Control.
Controlling.
Controlling from where?
From the rear of the court.
Rear of the court and mid. Mid to rear control is a critical factor for the male player. Agreed. What other things for the male player?
Attack.
What sort of attack?
Constructive attack to get the female into the game.
Constructive attack. So it's as much about the precision of the attack as probably the power of the attack. Yeah, it's being smart of where they're going to attack. Because it's slightly different from men's doubles because you're not going to rotate. So a lot of men's doubles attacking play now is set up for rotation play. Agreed? That's the biggest difference between the male player and the rear court for a mix because you're not looking for rotation. Not going to have rotation. That means the role is slightly different. And a lot of people forget that element. Anything else?
To just generally avoid any confrontation with the female.
You mean fighting, aren't you? I think that's life in general.
That's where I'm going with it.
Okay. So in general, the females are controllers of the forecourt. Finishers in the forecourt and they're defenders. Yeah? They need to be able to defend. They're critical factors. And you're welcome to disagree and you're welcome to that. But I would say if I've got a partner who can do those three things plus one other thing, that's the partner for me. What's the one other thing you need your female to be able to do? Really, really well.
Serve.
Female can't serve. Probably, there's a pair in the world at the moment who are as good as anybody in rallies, but they're not winning many tournaments because the girl can't serve at all. You'll see during the week. You'll pick a reason. One of the top players in the world, I would say, in a rally situation, can't serve. Puts a lot of pressure on the partner and it causes a lot of issues because they're not getting any easy points.
Was that English bit? Well, he married her.
I didn't say that.
She has good flick.
I didn't say that.
Doubly important to stay out of any arguments in that case. She's never married to him.
She's definitely having one of the best flicks of the world.
It's not much use, that's all you can do. So male players male players must have great control. They can have great power. You see the Chinese players, you know, they're hitting really hard. What you see from the younger Chinese winter players at the moment, who are mega, mega impressive, the boys coming through, incredible. They're getting up the court, they're controlling the play, they're playing very, very high on the court. Very, very high on the court. They're still able to get up and intercept on the rear court, but they are controlling the game. And they're too quick. They're too quick for most people, and there's a couple of Chinese players coming through at the moment from mixed doubles that are unbelievable. Best I've seen, better than Lee Yun Day, the same age by a margin, I would say. So you can watch it out, I think. Are they here? I think they're here.
James.
Worth having a look at, really. So, what I want to do is quickly run through. I haven't told Peter this, but he's already volunteered in his mind. I want to actually just demonstrate a few of those things and the decision-making elements. So, Peter's going to do some little bit of feeding, and the players are going to do a little bit of feeding. But we're going to do a very quick 15 minutes of watching a few of these exercises. Then what I want to do is go away and actually get them playing a few points of mix. In groups, you take a pair each. You identify the strengths and weaknesses of that group, and I want you to put a little program together of what works required for that pair. And then we'll maybe try a few little exercises that you can work with, and then come back in here and discuss how you actually develop a mixed doubles pair. Okay, it's a plan. Everybody's happy. Very good summary of that session. So in your pairs now, if you were going to prioritise, it can be the boy or the girl. Where were the biggest problems? What was the biggest problems in your pairs? Biggest problems.
We had serving.
Serving. Okay, one.
Choices by the point, and in terms of their mate, but also they're choosing to drive up when they maybe should play with control and find spaces, so shot selection.
So choices of the male players, yeah.
Pushing up on play and not being able to be
set. Yeah, boys playing a bit too deep, for example, the general one.
Girls hesitant to follow the shots.
Girls maybe hitting and waiting to see what happens rather than trying to anticipate. Yeah. Okay. Four good things. First one, I heard TJ, who's not here, I heard TJ ask a very good question at the end to one of the boys. He said, do you train for singles or doubles? He said, I train for doubles. And TJ said, well, okay, how much time a week then do you spend practicing your serve? And the answer was, he never practices his serve. So to the first point about serving, there's only one way to practice serve, and that's to serve. It's to serve. And it is very, very important. It's not tennis, but you can't win a point without serve in badminton, so it's a critical factor, and time should be allocated to it. And service in not just serving here, but serving with thought, service with anticipation. Again, you build it. You build it from just service to service with a change of direction and anticipation, service with the returner there, service with your partner there, do I take it, does he take it? So you can build it into your progressive planning. The second point that was mentioned was, remind me, which was the second one, was it the...
What did you say? It's still shot selection by boys.
Shot selection.
Boys playing too many shots that opponents can take above their height. Absolutely. So give me some good practices. How would you do that? How would you correct it? What exercises would you use to correct that?
More or less what you were running.
Yeah, and what methodology would you use? Or could you use? You can use some different ways. That was just a couple of exercises. Maybe there are some other things that you do that you want to mention?
Continuous rallying back to the centre. So rather than...
So you can do T jumps or T interceptions. Getting the boy to hit down different places, different angles. You can do it from the side, you can do it from the centre. From different stations as to the way you want them to do it, yeah? You can use multi-feed for that, it's okay. Because then as the coach you can control the situations that you want them in. if your particular zone maybe on forehand, this one's taking it just below net height on forehand, if you really want to put him in that position consistently, you probably want a multi-feed to start with to give him confidence of that, and then put it into the continuous rally situation. If you look at, it's much better now, but Chris Hancock used to have a lot of problems with exactly that on the backhand side. He liked to play with pace on the backhand side, so if it was just below net height, he'd put pace in. You have to do a lot of work to break that habit. It was a habit. He was very good on the forehand side, backhand side, instinctively. He liked to put pace on, he liked to step forward and put pace on. And whether the shuttle was there to hit or not, he was doing the same thing. He was better now.
It could also be, I remember you asking about, you know, coming in, closing that gap after just behind the girl. So it could also just be an awareness of what situation you put yourself in, if not by not closing that gap behind the girl. So if you're coming in a little bit late, of course you don't even know what, and then you actually choose the right, the wrong shot because of that situation you put yourself in by not being up close to her and close that gap on the mid court. So it could be that and not a technical issue. So
absolutely. And we didn't have any left-right combinations there, did we? Which is disappointing. I wouldn't like to talk about that. But if you watch closing down mid court space, and if you watch Joachim Fischer, he's probably the master of that, actually getting as high of the court as he possibly can. Watching what the opponent's doing, okay, if he's getting caught a lot, he'll drop the pace back a little bit, but his natural intent is to get as high up as he possibly can, which does what for his partner? What does that do for his partner? It means that she's automatically playing higher up the court, and where's Christina mega strong? That meter and a half between net and coming out and net. So the higher he can get up the court, the higher she'll play. If he hangs back, she has to hang back. And one of the key things you'll see in the mix is a key indicator that the position plays wrong is when the girls happen to step out to try and finish. It means she's not confident that the boy is close enough. Because if the boy's in the right position, the girl really should hardly ever have to actually step out to finish. The girl should never take a backward step forward. There are occasions, but in general, once the pressure's been applied, the girl's moving forward, she shouldn't have to move back because the guy should be right up behind her. Yeah. And I saw there were quite a few instances there, I'm sure you can see them in your head, where the girl was sort of reaching back to take shuttles here. And the only reason she's doing that is that she senses that the guy's very deep in the court. Next one that we talked about, what were the other problems? There's one more.
The guy pushing forward and setting.
That's that space. I mean, it's interesting. I think the footwork for the guys, I think there weren't many mixed specialists there, I would say, or that have trained for mixed, because there was really very little interception footwork, which was quite interesting. Even from a doubles perspective, it was quite interesting. I didn't really see step jump. Either side, I didn't see it very often at all, which is quite surprising. That's really important footwork for the guys in doubles. It was almost non-existent then. So there's some work to be done there. Again, maybe you could start with a multi-feed and then work it through to single shuttle solutions. What I did at the beginning with the Peter on the side of the court when we went to continuous rallies is actually quite a useful tool, because you can get some intensity and some tempo, and you can use players at that level. We could have put players on the side of the court to play that role, but what you keep is you keep the intensity, and very importantly, the players get a rhythm, whereas if there's some mistakes going on, they don't get rhythm with that sort of exercise, and very often you'll set what you think is a good exercise, but it breaks down because the picking shuttles up and new starts and where do we start and everything. If you take that out of their hands and you've got the shuttle coming in an interesting position wherever it is on the side of the court, then you can keep that. You can keep some intensity and get things moving very quickly, get them thinking. You can start them one time on attack, one time on defence. You can set up situations very quickly, which makes them think more quickly. and more consistently. And it's a useful tool to have in your armour to have those shuttles there. You're still in a good position to coach. Peter could have easily been coaching that session, no problem at all. But what he is doing is, at the same time, he can be controlling the tempo, the pace. He can be playing it into positions where he knows there's issues, etc., etc. It gives the coach control of the court and of the four players.
It stops everybody from their mistakes as well. So around them.
It does. There were a lot of mistakes when we started.
Because they get on with it, they don't think about it.
When we started 2-on-2, there were lots of mistakes. There were 3-4 shot rallies, and then only after maybe a minute and a half, so the rallies were really getting quite a decent level. Because they get some rhythm into it and they get some intensity into it, and that's really interesting. Okay, that's the end of that session. If there's any questions, I'm very happy to take them. If not, see you at the bar. See you at the restaurant.